So what you should hopefully be able to see on your screen is the agenda for today. So I'm going to talk pretty briefly on the standards of care because you're all aware of them. They're mailed out to you. They're on our website. A few points about the tertiary mental health trial. Then Jim will talk about treatment of the worker with mental health claim, whether the psychologist is practicing solo or will be one in the tertiary clinic trial. He'll also talk about mental health assessments, some of the standards and issues. He'll then talk about the reporting templates, and I think that might be specific to the tertiary centers. And the role of the psychologist, whether they're solo and in the trial, and then we'll end. So if we can go to the first slide, the standards of care. So the standards of care, and the document is available on our website. Just key in WCB-SAS and look under the care provider tab and then choose psychologist. So the qualifications are listed there. And I won't go through them, but on that website you'll see what the qualifications are. If you want to do mental health assessment for WCB, neuropsych assessment, vocational assessments, as well as treatment. One of the, so the standards will say the qualification of the individual who does the work. Delegation to non-WCB accredited providers occurs only for test supervision and administration of the instrument. So if, in terms of gaining approval for the funding and confirming that the worker does have a WCB claim and that it has been approved, what you would need to do is where the worker is not referred by the WCB, and in many cases we do that for the primary care provider, but where there's a direct referral to your office, you do need to obtain funding approval, and the form for that is on the website. Then you wait for it to be faxed back to you before you can start treatment, unless you're in a, you can bill the public system or the worker has some temporary funding in place. We would ask you to also, where you haven't treated the worker for 30 days, put in an authorization to treat form just to ensure that you are going to get paid. We're asking you to notify us if you can't provide a two-week intake timeline. In the tertiary centers, we're hoping in the trial to move that back to a week or 5 to 7 working days, depending on whether the worker has to receive travel monies from the WCB. Jim can talk more about this, but I understand psychologists do need to get consent for treatment and the employer contact as they begin their work with the client. And that would include notification if there's any employer relationship with yourself or with the clinic as well. That doesn't preclude you from treating the worker, but they would have to be aware of the relationship and agree to go forward with you. As treatment starts, it's useful, I think, to be transparent and upfront with the worker that you do need to and will be required to report any non-compensable barriers to return to work or to therapy to the WCB so the worker isn't surprised. And so they do, in fact, sign an informed consent. The worker also needs to be aware that there's quite a limited focus to treatment on a WCB claim. So if they have non-compensable issues, and I think we all have some, they need to be aware that that's not going to be and can't be dealt with in a really big way during treatment for the WCB claim. Certainly, sometimes we know the psychologists do a bit of work in that area to facilitate ongoing treatment and return to work, but the worker needs to understand that all of those non-compensable issues aren't going to get resolved in the treatment that's funded by the WCB. So generally, we ask that the initially the worker meet with the psychologist to review the mental health assessment, so they're very clear that the psychologist isn't making this up as they go along, it isn't WCB directed, that when they saw the mental health assessment, that report is now in the psychologist's or in the treatment team's hands, and that's what's being followed. We ask that they plan a treatment schedule. We're seeing cases where I'm not sure if the worker is being left to book in or what's happening, but there, one or two sessions occurs and then 6 weeks later we find that the worker has no further appointments and hasn't attended in all that time. So we would ask that just as in tertiary treatment, the worker be given their appointments ahead of time for 6 or 8 treatments or whatever's been recommended by the mental health assessment, and then notify the WCB if any are not attended. And it'll help you to move forward, and it'll help us to ensure that the worker meets their responsibility under the Act to make a full effort to recover and return to work. Next slide, please. The guidelines ask for contact with the employer soon after the worker is intaked, and I think it's helpful to include the worker in this contact if possible, so they're, everything is clear and transparent and they're part of the discussion. The employer can receive very, very limited information, so no medical information, but no diagnosis, etc. But I think it's important for them to be pre-warned of when the various forms of return to work might occur, so they can plan for those dates and times, as well as whether there's any on-site work, any in vivo work that's going to be done, so that there isn't a huge delay then when the time comes for, say, transitional return to work or in vivo experience in getting clearance for the work site. I think the employer needs to understand the date that may perhaps some transitional work might start, when the proposed timeline is to start a permanent or a graduated return to work, and whether there is expected to be temporary or permanent restrictions. Psychologists are asked to avoid advocacy, so I think good explanation to the injured worker up front when you're getting the consent of what the treatment will entail, what your responsibilities are to the WCB, and if benefits do cease or the worker doesn't agree, rather than get yourself into an advocacy role, simply ask them if they received appeals information, and they I'm sure they did if something was denied to them, and they can simply use the channels of appeal to do that. In non-mental health assessment cases, the WCB, unless it looks like return to work is imminent, would be arranging for a mental health assessment at around the 1 week mark. Where treatment or return to work isn't progressing as expected, if I could be contacted, I'll arrange for file review with Dr. Arnold, sometimes a teleconference with you, or perhaps a mental health assessment will be arranged, but it's useful not to find out after the whole treatment program has elapsed that it really wasn't ever progressing. If you can, avoid or definitely discourage the worker believing that there is going to be some expectation of retraining or a new job. If the mental health assessment is indicating that there should be no permanent restriction, they believe that the worker could return to the pre-injury job. The worker needs to understand that WCB won't be considering retraining or an alternate job at all. Okay, next slide. So talking a little bit about just additional features of the trial this fall, where we'll be offering primary care providers either solo psychology options or an option where the worker can see a psychologist in a tertiary treatment center. And as I mentioned before, that would give the psychologist the support of the team to help manage meetings, return to work, personal goal setting, etc., but also include an exercise program, and there's evidence to support that can be beneficial. So just some additional features about that trial this fall. So this will involve only files with a mental health assessment. It'll include a meeting with the psychologist and the tertiary treatment team both after an initial meeting between the worker and the psychologist only. We're hoping that meeting will include discussion about the roles and responsibilities of the psychologist and the treatment staff. should include establishment of a group supervised exercise schedule, and we know that there are requirements for a licensed provider in the clinic to see the worker before exercise commences, etc., look at comorbidities, maybe the Part Q, and all of those things would be done just as they usually would occur. The meeting, we assume, would also include setting of personal goals as well as the return to work and the WCB goals. The treatment staff, I think I've already talked about this, would manage the exercise program, report absenteeism, establish and chair the early meetings plus the return to work meetings with the employer, meet with the worker about personal goals. I think this will develop as we go through the trial. Reporting schedule, you'll have seen this on our website as well. The initial assessment report due within 3 days of the first meeting with the solo psychologist or with the psychologist and the team. Progress reports are every 3 sessions or every 3 hours, at least monthly. Discharge report within 3 days of discharge. The return to work schedule, if you can get that out to the employer and the WCB as early as possible so everybody has time to prepare for the return to work. Definitely, I think a meeting maybe or probably will be needed with the worker and the employer just to have a smooth transition into the return to work. So treatment centers do have an amended copy of the form. So the WCB on the website, you'll see, has initial and progress reports. We've done amended forms for the tertiary trial. Next page. So I'm now going to turn over to Dr. Arnold.
Over time, what we found is that with patients who've had mental health claims, that they often have very limited daily routine, seeing a psychologist for 1 or 2 hours of therapy. Sometimes they're even being seen 3 hours a week, but the rest of their time is relatively unscheduled. We've noted that for a long period of time, and we've also had workers who have combined physical and psychological claims that are in rehabilitation centers and having that daily routine of exercise and physical therapy treatment. We've done some look at what the literature suggests about this, and there is a lot. We consulted with a psychologist at the University of Regina who is researching quite extensively, and I'm sorry, I've forgotten his name, Chris.
It's Dr. Gord Asmundsen.
And there's a fair chunk of data showing us that being involved in physical activity is going to provide some enhancement of treatment effects for psychological service. I'm saying that quite generally. Exactly what the non-specific factors there are or whether there's actually physiological factors is beyond what we need to cover today. But there's some data that providing that routine and also some physical activity with some fitness goals will provide some enhancement. So that's what we're looking at trying to move forward with so that there's some sort of daily routine. The other things that were, as a psychological consultant, what I'm seeing is the files where they haven't progressed. And we see where there's been optimistic recommendations at the time of assessment or at the time of initial sessions with psychologists, and then the time frames sometimes are greatly exceeded. We have people who are suggested to, have, 10 or 20 psychological sessions and do a return to work within that time, and then I review a file when the person's been seen 70 or 80 times sometimes, and we've had perhaps the better part of a year elapse. So we're hoping to help these folks not become, that population where their claims have extremely long time frames. Next slide, please. I guess I'm saying things in advance, but what we've seen then is that psychological recovery is enhanced with routine and a team approach from those physical claims with combined. It should be noted that we do see some exceptions to the general sort of rule, but we want psychologists to be interacting with the treatment team in the tertiary center. That appears to enhance things. When we have psychologists in the community and are providing services in a freestanding way, we tend to see that combined treatment effect just isn't providing the gain that the worker would otherwise. So I would encourage, there are psychologists who are doing work within tertiary centers. There are psychologists who are doing work on their own. We encourage psychologists to consider relating themselves in some way or getting connected up with rehabilitation centers. This isn't an issue so much in the cities where there are tertiary centers, the larger cities. It is a bit of an issue for us in some of the outlying centers, and we're hoping to look at that in some of our smaller centers we're able to provide the same kind of service. I realize in the cities it's possible for psychologists to have fairly close to a full-time practice working with tertiary centers. It's not so possible in some of our outlying districts. But it's kind of an aspirational goal for us to enhance the teamwork. Next slide, please. Just in the way of, we have a mixed group here of psychologists plus people from rehabilitation centers, I wanted to make sure that there was some understanding of some of the sort of background to post-traumatic stress disorder and related diagnoses. So what we find is somewhere around 3% of Canadian adults would meet criteria in any given year for PTSD during that year. So it's a fairly common diagnosis, but it's a small population. We have half at least, and perhaps more depending on the demographics and epidemiology in a particular center, have one trauma event. That doesn't mean that they have PTSD per se, but they would have an event that might qualify as an initiator of that diagnosis. And of that group, 5 to 10% of that 50 to 90% actually develop a diagnosable trauma diagnosis. I say PTSD here. I'm talking about that constellation of diagnoses that we tend to talk about. With PTSD, we have a specific set of diagnostic criteria, and then we have some other diagnoses that aren't strictly PTSD, but as a way of shorthand, we tend to use that terminology. We also find statistically that there is a recovery within 6 to 12 months for most people. During that 6 to 12 month period, we tend to see quite variable functionality in terms of what people are doing in their daily lives or whether they've returned to work, etc. Next slide, please. There are a series of factors negatively affecting recovery, and that's other mental health problems and diagnoses, previous trauma, low social support, coping impairments with stress, and a history of anxiety. So these are folks that may have come in with some issues. The type of trauma, associated physical injuries, and post-incident dissociation, which is those individuals who have the very intense experiences of trauma and are moving in the direction of not being in contact with some of the actual conscious thought processes that are going on, and we call dissociation where people are essentially not perceiving things in quite normative ways. It's information for psychologists. Some of this data is coming directly from some of the compensation boards, that there is a consortium of workers' compensation boards in North America with 38 jurisdictions, American and Canadian, and a chunk of our data is also coming from WorkSafe BC, who systemize things quite well. So these are the factors that seem to be distilled. Next slide. So these are the statistics of when we see PTSD diagnoses occurring. This is distilled from a variety of sources from workers' compensation boards that have been reported. So you can, this is a number of workers who would have a PTSD diagnosis. It would necessarily be DSM-4 given, given the time frames in which. We can make these slides available to the participants as well. I think Chris can arrange to have them sent out. Yeah. These are fairly good statistics, though they're derived from so many different sources, it's kind of hard to pin down the exact sources, so I haven't attributed them. What I was interested in actually is that when we look at combat, that's one that we see a lot of news about. We have 30% of our soldiers who've experienced combat who've had a PTSD diagnosis, and we have varying statistics otherwise. Let's move forward a slide, please. Interestingly, this is again statistically based, but work-related tend to have less severe physical injuries than non-work-related PTSD diagnoses. So there's more PTSD. We also see in people with diagnoses of PTSD in work situations that we have more indication that there's labor relations and work conflicts. Labor relations means all of those issues around maybe the employee was having some conflicts with supervision or management, or perhaps there was some concern about workplace performance and things moving towards discipline. We also see more legal and quasi-legal issues. Quasi-legal, I'm referring to things like union grievances, human rights complaints, those kinds of things. In terms of legal issues, there may be consultations with lawyers or actual attempts to have some sort of civil action or some other administrative law kinds of actions. This last point is my distillation. I think that because of some of these statistics, we have a general insurer perception of more secondary issues affecting disability and function. So when the time frames are longer for people who have mental health claims, the case managers tend to perceive, whether it's justified or not, that there's more of these secondary issues because they know some of these statistics. That may or may not be fair, but you will, in communicating with WCB, sometimes have a sense that they're questioning claims, and the answer is, yeah, they are, because they have this general perception that these are troubling claims and that there must be something else driving this. The next slide, please. Factors promoting severity, upper versus lower limb amputations, worse than burns. Interpersonal confrontation versus actual accidents with physical injuries are worse. And interpersonal confrontation here refers to the people who have either something that's assaultive in some way or threats of assault or verbal harassment kinds of things. There tends to be an externalization of the causation and blaming others. That may be completely justified, but it's a factor that exists. Litigation of any kind. Poor physical recovery. This, again, is part of the reason that we're looking at the physical status of these folks. They often tend to be in relatively poor physical health. They may have had lifestyle habits that are not what we would see as enhancing, sort of good general adjustment all around in terms of a whole person kind of a model. And then we see issues with general mental health functioning pre and post. Sometimes that's formally diagnosed and the person has been treated. And in most cases, when it's been actually formally treated before, that makes things easier for the treating provider because that's been identified and the person has some psychological mindedness around dealing with that responsibly. Sometimes this is a projection in terms of understanding the individual's history, where there's been a lot of difficulty with the person's adjustment over the course of their life and perhaps untreated. And when it's been untreated and all of a sudden we have the mental health claim, we have what I've termed the Moby Dick syndrome, which is, approximately quote, upon the back of the whale, Captain Ahab piled all the hurts and sorrows, all of his disappointments, everything that had ever troubled him from his entire life, he piled on the back of the whale, and if his chest had been a cannon, he would have fired his heart out upon the back of the whale. That's not necessarily fair, but I think it's a lovely quote. What you see sometimes is you can pin that this crystallized work issue in which there are some entitlement attached that you can then perhaps start to filter everything through that lens of this particular event in this workplace. Next slide, please. In terms of the actual events themselves, this is derived directly from WorkSafe BC data, that 84% have directly experienced a traumatic event themselves, and 16% have witnessed a traumatic event. This is normally that someone else has been killed or very severely injured. with the that 16%, the majority of those would be, this would be the trucker who was in an accident and someone was killed on the highway and they were in attendance for that event. 45% have had additional diagnoses in addition to the PTSD, depression and anxiety. So it's a mood disorder of some kind. One of the issues with diagnosis with PTSD and with case managers understanding that, if we say that someone has PTSD and that they also have a depression, the insurer looks at that and says, two separate diagnoses. That may or may not be correct. And part of our communication as psychologists is to communicate clearly that the person has PTSD and has a separate depression or has PTSD and some additional mood disorder that is part of that overall PTSD syndrome. So we need to be clear as communicators about that. We also, it reminds me of the one where we have people with quite severe pain, and then they also are receiving a depression diagnosis. And the WCB case manager may begin to ask questions about, is this a separate mental health diagnosis, or is that depression diagnosis, that mood disorder diagnosis, part and parcel of the pain issue? So we need to, as psychologists, make sure we're clearly communicating how we understand that. Because if we start to separate out some of these things, we're not being fair to workers, and sometimes we have an adjudication that way down the road at the time of appeal, I'm saying, well, actually, no, it's part of an overall PTSD picture or an overall pain picture. Next slide, please. In terms of recovery, with the WorkSafe BC data, we have 43% returning to work at the same job, 3% return to work at a different job with the same employer. So approximately half are returning to work at the pre-injury job. And then a small percentage are returning to the same type of work with a different employer, and 34% are choosing a different an industry altogether. The WCB Saskatchewan does do psychological PFIs. There is a protocol for doing those assessments, and some of the psychologists will have received requests to provide those assessments. Overall, it's a minority of people who receive those. We will be able to ultimately generate some of this data for ourselves, but I have no reason to believe that BC's statistics would be markedly different from ours. In terms of the symptoms, the re-experiencing and hyperarousal are the ones most associated with work impairment, and more so when experienced at the workplace. These are joint. The person is going back to the workplace, hasn't been there, doing the job site visit or some live exposure, and is experiencing some symptoms that weren't anticipated within the office setting, and they're having some difficulty managing those. So, if these symptoms aren't managed, they're the ones that will probably impair that worker from returning to that work site or returning to that kind of work. So I think some of our discussions of these patients within tertiary centers then will be about, you know, what's the level of some of these sort of more cardinal symptoms. And again, this is statistically derived data. Individual patients will obviously varying in their own individual differences. Next slide. We see in Saskatchewan, there's a tendency, I think, sometimes to think, okay, it's PTSD that WCB covers. Not necessarily true. We see all sorts of other diagnoses that are less frequent, but they are part of WCB's mandate in Saskatchewan to cover. There's burnout due to documented excessive duties and work hours. This is a minority, but it does occur. This is the individual who was working with two others for some reason, one or two of those people is off, and now they're doing the jobs of two people or three people, and we can document that there were excessive hours and that there were excessive duties. WCB in Saskatchewan will accept those claims if it can be documented that that's in fact happened. We also see cumulative issues. That's an interesting one because we sometimes have an incident that occurred, 3 years ago, and it was quite significant. The worker continued to work and may have been informally accommodated, which is quite common in this province. Then management changes and the person is being asked to do some duties that were informally accommodated, or perhaps there was a minor issue that seems to have brought a flood of the previously experienced traumatic types of issues that have come up. Those ones are often coming at us after quite a thorough investigation and sometimes through appeal, but we are certainly seeing those, and that's part of what WCB Saskatchewan covers. The last one of these, the acceleration of pre-existing conditions, is quite interesting. So you have someone who has a history of some form of disorder. It most often would be a mood disorder, but it may be a previous PTSD in some other circumstance. And then they've gone through an assessment, and there's opinion that this diagnosis has recurred, and that the recurrence causation is from the workplace incident. So that acceleration of an existing condition, a pre-existing condition, is accepted. That's, again, a minority of claims. Psychologists sometimes are concerned about the worker being disadvantaged because there is that pre-existing history, and the answer is that's an adjudication question and not necessarily so. So we see claims that are accepted because there is a reprise, but a clear causative event of the current diagnostic picture. I think that's quite important to understand these other ones. In terms of reactive mood disorders, WCV covers other anxiety disorders in that whole constellation, and some depressive disorders as well. Things that we have historically called adjustment disorders are quite obvious in their coverage. Some of the others are not as obvious, but they are covered if the causation can be clearly linked by WCB to the event. So you don't have to find a trauma diagnosis, and you don't have to try to filter everything that you're diagnosing through that frame if it doesn't fit, notwithstanding that that is the dominant diagnosis that we see. PTSD and associated trauma diagnoses. With DSM-5, we have some fairly cumbersome phraseology that is a diagnosis of trauma, and those are acceptable, though I sometimes have to interpret those to case managers, and that's fine. Next slide, please. Our experience in Saskatchewan is that there is quite a large subset of mental health claims that exceed expected timelines entirely. We have felt sometimes this is worker-based factors, and sometimes this is practitioner or service delivery or service availability factors. We are okay with the worker factors because we want to help the workers and improve service delivery, but we certainly want to enhance the treatment they're receiving so it's not a practitioner or service availability and resourcing issue. We see this issue of worker expectancies for impairment and return to work. They're very variable, and people receive all sorts of information from the internet and from other people, and sometimes from practitioners who give workers information that may not be correct about what will happen on the basis of their claim. And we see some of that post-injury care conform some of that negative expectation for return to work and return to function. I've started using that RTF abbreviation. It may be less familiar, but I think it's helpful. It means that non-work stuff. The person, you know, getting up in the morning, attending to family and relationships and doing other necessary things like shopping, etc. We also see that diagnoses often have poor foundation when we see patients at the time of assessment or when they're coming to us, that they have received some expectation of a diagnosis or an impairment, and it may or may not be justifiable based on some more objective or thorough assessment. Next slide, please. So I've communicated this before, but I think it's worth everyone understanding that we're defining three levels of diagnosis. So that reason for visit is simply the physician most commonly is having to enter some ICD kind of code so that they can send it into Medicare and derive a billing from that 7-minute encounter. That obviously is not going to meet criteria for any sort of acceptance of diagnosis. We then have this working diagnosis or clinical diagnosis situation where there's probably some basis and some practitioner is working with a patient in an EFAP or in the public system or in a private clinic, wherever that is. And there's some basis for this, but we haven't any understanding from an adjudicative level or medical legal type level that the working diagnosis might be causally linked. It may be appear obvious to you as a practitioner, but that's a determination of the WCB that they have responsibility to make. And so then we have that third level of assessment, justified diagnosis. I don't actually know what to call this. I made this up when I made up these slides and called it assessment, justified diagnosis, and tentatively made an abbreviation. Technically, I guess I would call it a medical legal sort of level diagnosis, because that's kind of what it is. But we're in the WCB world, we're not in a court, and I don't want to lead us in that direction either. So I'm kind of coining that term for now. If somebody comes up with a better one, we just need to know what we're talking about when we talk about these three levels. So the WCB is looking at this third level of assessment justified diagnosis, and we have some standards for the mental health assessments about this. Next slide, please. Now, mental health assessments have been coming about in various ways. Mental health assessments come about because WCB has yet to make a determination of whether the claim is acceptable. This is a troubling type of assessment for psychologists to do, because the worker would know that based on the assessment, their claim may be accepted or rejected. And then we therefore have some secondary reasons related to entitlement that should be driving some of the patient presentation at that time. But we need to assess that, of course. We have some desire for a mental health treatment plan. The diagnosis has been accepted, and we need to know what the treatment plan will be. Sometimes someone is suspecting a diagnosis during the claim handling and treatment. This is arising quite frequently in our tertiary centers, where the person has a physical claim and all the attention has been devoted to handling, you know, the serious injuries. Maybe there's surgery, maybe there's other care that's occurred, and it's not until the person arrives at the treatment center for the attendance to the physical injury that it begins to be determined that there is some psychological aspect. Workers at the time of secondary and tertiary centers, we hope at the tertiary, the tertiary assessment level, the physical claims, that the psychological screen will identify that the person has some mental health issues, but we're certainly not perfect at that. And I think any psychologist that's in attendance probably has had some experience of the tertiary center situation where the patient is requested to have some enhanced assessment because we think there's a psychological diagnosis going on, a mental health diagnosis. Some assessments, therefore, occur before the treatment center referral and some during. In this effort to move claims to the tertiary centers, we're going to see that in virtually all of these cases that mental health assessment has occurred and the person is being referred, but we're still going to have this other group. It's still going to occur for us, and we expect that with you know, the hopefulness is the expertise that's derived, that the tertiary centers will be identifying some of the barriers that occur with unidentified claims and will be attending to those more expeditiously. We have a real problem with people coming into tertiary centers, receiving all of that physical care, and then late in the day we're identifying that there's a mental health diagnosis and barriers within that. We want to hopefully identify that much, much sooner. We also have the issue, regardless of mental health assessment, but most often not if there's been a mental health assessment, but there is request at times of follow-up assessment within tertiary centers that there is probable or there is an accepted PTSD or some other psychological mental health diagnosis, but we have recommended that there be some additional psychological assessment in the tertiary center. So the psychologists are being asked to do some additional diagnosis at times within this as well. Some of these claims and files and patients can be very complicated. Next slide, please. Causation is a very sticky issue. that the person has a diagnosis doesn't mean that there's causation, even if it's entirely clear to everyone from the caregiver side that there is a diagnosis and it's logically connected. Ultimately, this is deferred to the WCB. So there's been a determination that we're not asking causality types of decisions to be made or discussion of that. We're asking for diagnoses to be made, and the insurer, as the third-party adjudicator, needs to make that decision. There have been comments at times that when we see a diagnosis, psychologists at times are interpreting things within that diagnosis as causation, and there may be other factors that it's more difficult for them, given the focus of assessment, to see. So the WCB files are more complicated. Next slide, please. So the mental health claim acceptance really has these first three decisions. The WCB has the ability then to say yes, the injury is WCB's responsibility. It may relate the diagnosis to non-injury causes and refuse the claim, even though you might see some connection clinically, or it may relate the diagnosis to an acceleration of some pre-existing type of condition. With all of this, the WCB has the ability under their decision-making and legislation to determine what extent the responsibility is as well. So we will see times where the WCB has said, yes, we're accepting responsibility, but they're accepting it for a particular duration, and based on some determined adjudication and some statistical timelines, they may say that, you know, the WCB is providing, 3 months of care, 12 or 15 sessions, and their responsibility will cease. Some of these decisions will sometimes seem to caregivers, they have, to me in my practice, to be arbitrary and unreasonable at times from a caregiver standpoint. We have to defer the responsibility to the third-party adjudicator for this decision type of situation, which is quite difficult, and then, you know, make sure the worker knows what the appeal steps are, and that they take advantage of those. I find this actually probably one of the more difficult parts of professional practice for myself, when you have a patient who you see has a legitimate something going on, and then the adjudication doesn't make sense to you as a practitioner. We're in a situation where we have both the immediate patient, who's our primary responsibility, and then the secondary responsibility to the corporate client. I view it as being in a courtroom where the judge ultimately makes the determination of something, and that decision can be appealed as well. So a bit of a sticky issue.
Who does the adjudication?
The case manager starts and does the initial decision making based on a very large set of procedures and policies. So they will go through and apply the policies and procedures with the WCB claim. And then if the worker is unhappy with that, then the case manager has a team that they work with, and they actually work quite closely with their team, and that they meet and talk about claims all the time with their group, and their team leader then is the next person that would be responsible for that, and then it goes above the team leader for, I'm not sure, there's at least two or three more levels of appeal after that. What I've noted is with the rise of this, and probably people are familiar with the term internal audit, so if a case manager is making a decision, they have to, and they may really think that the claim is justified, they have to justify it in sort of an internal audit type of context to their team and their team leader, which may tell them that the decision you're making doesn't apply the policy correctly, please apply the policy correctly, and then, revise decision. So sometimes workers are personalizing it with case managers, and it's really, you need to personalize it to the agency, which is the whole of the WCB. I think this is probably true. My experience with private insurance companies tells me the same thing, that the immediate case representative for a private insurer is subject to the same types of review. They have to adjudicate policy, and they can't make arbitrary decisions because somebody will scrutinize. And in the WCB system, it is the appeal system. The appeal system can work very well and very quickly, and other times is extremely cumbersome and probably prolongs claims and impairs recovery and everything else, but we're kind of stuck with that at the moment. Also note that employers have right of appeal, meaning that the employer is, it's a bit like a car accident. You have a car accident, you're at fault, you're paying a premium on your insurance for a while and not getting those beneficial deductions of enhanced costs for your insurance. The employers will carry these claims as a penalty on their payroll tax, which is what WCB is. Therefore, they have a right of appeal. And one of the things we've seen a rise in is because some of these claims and collections of claims for some employers have been quite high, that they have retained outside agencies, often out of province, which are on their behalf scrutinizing their claims, and then they are coming to WCB and saying that they want to have an independent assessment external to WCB because they don't think the quality of the work that WCB has done with the mental health claim is up to par. So we want to make sure that we're withstanding that sort of different form of audit on our practice as well, and that we're doing what our best practices. So I'm wanting us to not have workers being subjected to that sort of very difficult kind of process. Of course, understanding that WCB is the final decision maker on claims in Saskatchewan, there is no appeal to a court. WCB does it in a final way. With change of legislation, by the way, workers can request their file at any time now, and the freedom of information has become much more free in that regard. Next slide, please. So the template for the mental health assessment has been revised. Those of you doing mental health assessments should be using the new templates. And if you don't have that, please make sure you obtain that through Chris and through Sam Payne, the Chris's assistant. We initially trialed it with a few people, a few psychologists, and they said that it was an improvement. And so we said, please use it and provide comments as necessary. So it's one of these situations where any suggestions will be gratefully received, and any lack of clarity in some of the questions you're asked within the mental health template, please let us know what those are. We want to revise this, and we look at a bit of a rolling revision kind of model with this. Next slide. Okay. Right, I've spoken about this already. Note that if a psychologist in that second, I guess it's a small bullet, but a major heading, if a psychologist believes that there, or the team believes there's a psychological diagnosis that we haven't already known about, we don't advance that clinically. We advance that on the basis of assessment information that we have to generate. So in most cases, we'll be asking tertiary level psychologists to conduct some assessment in that context. On some occasions, it will go externally for a mental health assessment. So there's still going to be this requirement that psychologists be prepared to do some enhanced psychological assessment and testing. Next slide. In general, the standards for mental health assessments is we expect to see at least 1 month multidimensional personality inventory, and we prefer to see two. And we need to consider psychological practice standards and the use of multiple measures. I am suggesting to you that you consider in mental health assessments to use an MMPI because of the number of validity scales there and its ability to withstand scrutiny. We're seeing people wanting to use particularly the PAI. It's the data I've seen in medical legal contexts about its validity scales are it's not adequately differentiating people who may have secondary reasons for disability from those who don't. And in medical legal contexts, in courtroom kind of situations, I've testified a couple of hundred times in Saskatchewan, I would not go into a court without an MMPI. So I would suggest that you consider one of the two current versions of the MMPI. I'm not saying I can't dictate to you, and there's good reasons to select other measures sometimes, but you need to be considering that if you're using a measure that has more rudimentary validity scales, that you consider some other assessments. I've seen people use some of the specific deception scales, the Paul House, for instance, sometimes the Sims and some other things. You can approximate what might be required here. All of these mental health assessments are coming to me at this point for review. So if I have some questions about them, what I don't want to be doing is saying, I don't know that I can trust your assessment data here, and we're going to have this worker participate in more assessment that could have been done right at the get-go. And then we have, because the worker knows that there were some questions, why am I being sent for a second assessment? Then we have some secondary issues that tend to crop up, and then we see more noise in subsequent psychological assessments and validity scale type of assessment. So we do expect that you consider carefully what you're using for instruments and are prepared to justify that. When we have a specific diagnostic issue, if it's a PTSD situation, you need to use a trauma-specific measure of some kind, please. Particularly one of the multidimensional measures for trauma that is screening across the symptomatology for PTSD. We're seeing commonly people are using the TSI or the DAPS are the two most common. Again, there are other measures out there. You can determine that, and you need to determine that within some, justifiable clinical reasoning, please. And then ultimately, we expect a very good professional opinion. We want to see comments about clinical results and validity of presentation results as well. The revised template asks you about those questions specifically, and then also asks you to comment on diagnoses that you considered and ruled out, and then you're having to justify how you arrived at the diagnosis that you did accept. So this is both, at this point, I'm telling you what the mental health template contains, but I'm also suggesting that that you have this kind of assessment-mindedness and consider these kinds of principles when you're working within the tertiary centers as well. Some of you in the tertiary centers won't be doing mental health assessments because that's not part of your practice per se. You won't be doing those freestanding, more medical legal type of assessments, but you will be doing some of this clinical thinking and be doing some testing within and some enhanced assessments within the tertiary centers. Okay. Next slide, please. If you're using checklists of symptoms, the people reading your reports do not know what they are. So when you give a Beck depression inventory, that sounds every bit of it as impressive as a personality assessment inventory, doesn't it? Yet we know that there's not validity scales attached to that. So please identify those checklist-type measures. It's unfair of me to call them checklist-type measures. Some of them are more sophisticated than that, but you understand what I'm talking about. I would hope. So please identify what the measures are doing and describe them, and don't just use abbreviations or assume that your clientele who are reading your report will understand that. Often the only psychologist reading your report is me, and everyone else is in another discipline or is a case manager. Your clinical assessment of validity is not sufficient. We see also that clinical assessment of validity cropping up in situations where the person has reported some statistically rare and infrequent and perhaps not necessarily credible in combination type of collection of symptoms according to validity scales. And we see sometimes what I can only say is heroic attempts by psychologists to try to explain away that the person presented statistically invalidly to some degree on the testing. You may believe the patient, but you have to report those results as clearly and based on the statistical information as possible. I also may be reviewing your raw test results. I'll request those through healthcare, or they'll be requested through the healthcare facilitator. They want me. I'm subject to a bit of an internal audit myself. They're asking me really, and I have to be able to say yes. I looked at the test data, and the test data showed me, and I have to be able to write a memo that says that I have done that that job. So I really encourage you to report those results. You can report all the factors that you think contribute. If you see that someone did report some things that suggest a statistical over-report and you think that there's some reasons that make that reasonable, please let us know what those are. But report the results, please. And the WCB may do some decision-making based on those results at the time of your assessment, or may do some decision-making after review. But you can't be a patient advocate in this regard, please. And we see a tendency. Psychologists all want to help people and are generally, in my view, really doing the best they can for their patients. But you have a corporate client here, and you also have to do the best you can for that corporate client. So I encourage you. This does lead to an additional issue. Because you're saying things that patients may not like, workers may at times be angry with you and may want to advance professional level complaints. We have discussed this thoroughly at WCB, and the opinion at WCB is that if you are receiving a complaint to the college about a patient, I will review the report on your behalf, and if I haven't reviewed it already, and if necessary, make representations to the college. And you know, the basic opinion is that if the WCB thinks that you have met the practice standards, that we would suggest that the complaint is probably not acceptable to the college. And the WCB does have a legislative mandate to be the final decision maker about workers. That hasn't arisen yet, but with some experience from some professional college activity, the professional college, our regulatory body, has not wanted to enter into those discussions, which I understand. They have their mandate, but this is an area that does provide some level of risk for practitioners, but we really do want to know what you actually think and what your professional opinion is, so we don't want you to restrain that. So I would ask that if you do receive some form of complaint directly from a worker, I hope it would go to the tertiary center and that can be discussed there and go through the WCB appeals process. But if it goes in this other direction, that you would please let me know, and myself and probably, if necessary, WCB legal department would become involved at that point as well. Okay. Next slide, please. We have a template for mental health treatment reports, and so what we're looking at is right now we have what I consider to be quite cumbersome reports for what we're calling the solo practice, and then an equally but different cumbersome report for what's going on in treatment centers. I haven't heard a lot of positive feedback from psychologists about them. They're annoying to fill out, and they don't tend to aim at the issues that we think are relevant. So we have a revised template, and that it will be one template for all, we hope, that it will work in all circumstances. And we ask again that you use this template, and then please let me know, let Chris know, make comments. Probably you're going to be sending them in an email format or something like that so we can review and revise. There are places on the template that are some accountability for you within the mental health claims that are within the treatment center, so that we know that the clinic and the psychologist are interacting. The templates will be provided to you. They ask you to identify the diagnoses that you're treating. the WCB is finally moving into, we're asking you to use DSM-5. The WCB has been slow to implement that simply because it's a cumbersome organization and it takes a while to move. We are going to be retaining the GAF from the DSM-4 because that's required for, from the AMA, the American Medical Association Guides to Permanent Impairment. That's one of the things that they track for if there's a psychological PFI in the future. So we ask that you use DSM-5. There'll be some time where, you know, there's obviously tolerance for DSM-4 and there may be some discussion about that. I know the college has said thou shalt move to DSM-5, but WCBs are using diagnoses for their adjudicative purposes as well. So please do that. In the template, you'll note that there are some specific questions that are simply yes, no. And some of the questions you can answer with a yes or a no. It's a checklist. Did you do this? You know, is the worker functional at home in a daily task? Yes, no. If it's no, explain whether or not. If it's yes, well, then we don't have an issue to address. So we hope it's going to be really quite quick and easy for you to do and not cumbersome. The timelines for the usual tertiary center reports are every 3 weeks. These reports are submitted to the WCB in and they're filed at the WCB. So your progress reports as psychologists will be submitted in that way. There is nothing to tell you as a psychologist that you cannot submit some other narrative information. When it comes to reviewing a file, if there is other narrative information, it can be, you know, if it's pages and pages, we'll object. But if there are some issues that are arising and the psychologist has you know, dictated or typed up a, you know, several sentences about, you know, we're doing cognitive behavior therapy aimed at some stresses and pain, and we're planning on doing some live exposure around the specific anxiety-provoking stimuli at the workplace. If that's there, then we know on review that that's happening. I realize for treatment centers that might be, oh my goodness, I'm going to have to throw in another paragraph from the psychologist. Yeah, sorry, you might. But we'd encourage that kind of documentation, and you're certainly entitled to do that. What that does then when it comes to time to complete these actual forms, that you have a bunch of information already contributed and can enhance that that communication. So this is going to be the same form for everyone. You can see what's required. The italics is simply for guidelines, so just delete that. So you're going to check off what kind of report it is. Yeah, you can move down. And you can see the DSM diagnoses. You're going to be asked to identify return to work factors and restrictions. And then there's some functional information and various more or less bookkeeping kinds of information. You'll note in here that there's some specific requirements. You know, if not at work, have you contacted the employer? Yes, no. And then we want some description of what's happened and then some details about that because they're involved.
This is Linda James, a treating therapist. So if I'm treating with Dr. Kushik here with this kind of thing, so we're going to have this type of format, and then what physical kinds of things do you want added in by the physiotherapist? If you're trying to incorporate an exercise program and physical and mechanical type of information and that kind of stuff. Because at present on a comprehensive program, we would have our...
Did you just scroll down? I'm sorry to interrupt.
We have a section
previous page. Previous page. Stop there. No, go back up. The bottom part of that page, please. Okay, stop. Is the worker participating in a physical exercise program? Yes, no. Has the worker missed any scheduled appointments? If yes, specify how many reasons. So that's on this form where this goes. That's where the
contract. But you don't want any in-depth of if it's a combined stuff with some physical treatment or...
Somebody else will have to speak to that issue. I'm a psychologist.
If this was a combined physical mental health claim, it would be coming through as a regular tertiary claim. And you would be using regular tertiary reporting. This is just purely for the mental health claims that come through the tertiary center.
So this question here is obviously the one where the physical therapist or OT or whatever is contributing. contributing to.
Contributing.
So what is for the mental health claims.
What if you have a mental health claimant who has a fairly physical job, but in a way, like, are you expecting an FAE, a report on their functional? No.
No.
Just get through the mental health barriers first.
Yes. That's right.
Oh, but so I would just like to follow up.
More traditional tertiary program for that portion?
No, we would not.
Okay, so I would follow up with that question that individual would say, is that if they do have a heavy type of job and they've been off work for a year, 6 months, and I'm helping guide with a psychologist return to work, we're at a high risk of that person injuring themselves, going back to that without knowing what physical, like, without an FAE to know where their physical condition is at. So I'm concerned of the risk of those individuals that they may now we have someone who's psychologically, I'm worried about being back at work due to all those other peripheral type of things, and then they injure themselves. See, I shouldn't have been back there. I wasn't ready, you know, adding into that. So that is my concern, even though it is a more of a mental health type thing, but on those, if it's a sedentary workplace and they just need introduction and the psychologist reintroducing them into the environment, that's one thing. But if it's a person who's fallen 16 feet and yes, they're physically fine now, but they have to lift, or they saw, let's say they saw a death in their workplace. They were the witness of the workplace, but they were physically injured. But now they have to go back and lift that lumber, that repetitive lumber, and all that kind of stuff. That's where I'm concerned about not knowing what the FAE is.
So we'll have to have some further discussion about that, because I understand what you're saying. Because there may be a physical therapist involved, is there now a responsibility?
Yeah.
But just so you know, currently, where mental health clients are being treated in solo doctor, psychologist offices, there is no physical program to return them to work. And I have to say, we haven't had a problem either. Obviously, they maintain themselves or do some work to prepare to return to the work site on their own physically. But we'll give that some thought, because, yes, I understand what you're saying. There is a responsibility now that there's a rehab center involved.
If I were to speak to what the general, you know, if we look at what the causation for injury is and the kinds of workplaces that these mental health claims are arising from, they are generally these interpersonal confrontations, and they don't tend to be people who have, we do see some, and the ones that you would be exposed to in a tertiary center to date would be the ones that do have these heavy claims, you know, have heavy jobs. The ones that the target group here are, you're probably going to see that the jobs are not with a lot of physical demand, except for the ones from correctional centers, some of those. And that's a... the next project will be, how do we deal well with the people who have claims arising out of correctional centers, which seems to be a very high epidemiology for Saskatchewan right now. But I think this is a very good issue to discuss. I mean, if we're trying to, we can't expose physical therapists and physical staff to risk in providing an exercise program. I think we're going to have further discussion of that, and there may be both general programmatic discussion as well as perhaps some case-by-case discussion. This isn't going to be an extremely large clientele that comes through this. What this is a small number of people whose claims are very prolonged and are quite damaging to them and very expensive to the system. So I expect that some of our discussions will be necessarily case-by-case versus... You know, we can't answer all questions by having an overall sort of procedure, but I think that the physical practitioners in the coalition probably need to discuss some of that. And it's going to be a trial to try to move forward. We think we're on to the right direction, and it's going to need to be, we're going to have to work together to hopefully make it work and do the right thing.
My initial thought in response to Linda would be, or not necessarily responding to you, Linda, but my thought would be that in the template, if we could at least acknowledge some testing has been done that shows the client is safe to return from an objective perspective, then that would potentially mitigate some of the risk that we might have with our college.
Yeah.
So we don't necessarily need to fill your report with that data, but as long as we can have it in the patient's file so that if we do get a complaint, it's indicated in the report to you guys, to the board, that we've done it, and then it can be presented to the board to show objectively that we've proven the client safe.
I made a note of that. Would you be able to send that to Chris as an email, just what the question you think would be?
Sure.
That would be great.
The one thing, and it can be incorporated. As physiotherapists that we're asked to fill in a lot of times, is we'll get these forms from the employer listing what can they lift, what can they do, and when it can, that kind of stuff. That is out of a psychologist's general practice. And I would think you guys would be at risk, and other than filling out your area.
I'm just going to stop you for a second. There's another document attached to that email, which is the psychological restrictions and barriers. Can you maybe just dump this document now and bring up the third one in that email?
It should be here.
So if you can close this document and bring up, there's in the email there was a third document in the same email.
You should be able to see it now.
Oh, there you go, restrictions, there you go. So this is going to be distributed to you as well. So it's a guideline of what some of the restrictions and barriers may be. So this will be sent to everyone. It with our disruption last week, it wasn't sent in advance. I would have preferred to have you. So it's not necessarily comprehensive, but hopefully some guidelines on what some of the restrictions are.
So I have a question about that. So if the restrictions are mental health or psychological based, will the psychologist be doing return to work planning with the employer then?
With the psychologist and the tertiary center jointly. One of the enhancements with this, Michelle, is that we're looking at that psychologists sometimes have some difficulty with the communication with employers. They have some, you know, they're busy people, and we're hoping that the tertiary center can assist with some of that employer liaison. The tertiary centers have shown a lot of good experience with that liaison with the employer, so we're looking at the tertiary center and the psychologist and the employer and the worker. But the psychologist becomes responsible for advancing the psychological restrictions.
The reporting templates that are being provided today are draft copy only. We're looking for your input on them, but please don't start using them yet. Thus far, we have worked with the care providers in establishing the mental health tertiary trial. I now need to do all the prep work, including review of reports internally at WCB. So we'll be announcing when the trial starts, when you can start using the forms. We'll get them on the website at that time. So yeah, don't start using them yet. And number two, if you've got input, can you please get it into us next week to 10 days maximum?
I have one other thing for the psychologists. I'm at WCB on Wednesdays. First thing in the morning, they tend to have, there's a deluge upon me and many fires to put out. It's not a good time to call. And I request that you don't leave me messages because there's far too many and I won't get to you. But usually by about 2:30 or 3 o'clock, things have settled a bit. And if you have something specific from a professional practice perspective, please call me. I would much rather speak to you while you're in the midst of providing service, doing an assessment, interpreting some testing, dealing with something. I would like to hear from you because it makes the service to the worker better, and it also means that I may be not coming back sort of way after the fact. The phone number you should try is 933-7913, 933-7913. If I don't answer, if you leave a message, I do not guarantee I will pick up your message. I ask you to call in about 10 minutes in general. Just try to get a hold of me sort of from, I would say, probably 2:30 onward. If it's something really urgent or, you know, it's not a Wednesday, everybody, you know, knows how to contact Chris, and Chris can alert and sometimes will coordinate a meeting. And suggest a time, but I would far rather be a consultant that's useful at the time of problems arising. I participated in a number of, you know, setup meetings as well as ad hoc you know, it turns out that the psychologist and the treatment center personnel are all available. Can we all just talk right now? I have the ability to bring up files right on the computer at WCB and deal with it very expeditiously. So, 933-7913. And the message will say, probably I'm really busy and don't leave me a message. I don't know what it says. Thank you very much. I very much appreciate you taking your time. I would encourage the psychologist to document a couple of hours of continuing education.